what I want to start off with the history of Fort Norfolk is, I want to first dispel a myth. The original Fort Norfolk was not built with slave labor. That's been something that people have been saying for years, but my research shows different. Okay, when John Jacob Rivardi, who was the engineer in charge of building the fortifications at Norfolk and in Baltimore, came to Norfolk to build the fort, what they did is they called up the Virginia militia. And one thing that they don't do is they didn't let blacks come to militia gatherings. They didn't have them as substitutes in the militia. And the labor you see going on here is that they're putting out a regular dispatch of who's working on the fort, and they called up the militia to do that. So it's very doubtful they had any slave labor building Fort Norfolk in 1794. Now, this is a picture of Fort Nelson, because there are no pictures of Fort Norfolk from 1794, 1795. If you look at this picture, you'll see this area right here on the picture. This is basically what Fort Norfolk looked like too, except Fort Norfolk only had 7 guns that faced down the Elizabeth River. There was nothing in the back of Fort Norfolk. It was strictly a line of guns, and the guns fired through the wall. But it wasn't very long after they built Fort Norfolk that an event took place, and we find it in the Norfolk newspaper in September 8, 1795, and it's an ad in the paper. And this ad is a $40 reward for a runaway slave, a guy named Patrick. Well, it seems that Patrick would be running around claiming he was a free man because a soldier at Fort Norfolk, see if I can get it there, right here, a soldier at Fort Norfolk forged him a freedom pass. In other words, a pass that said that he was a free man and he took off. So this is the first mention of any black person at Fort Norfolk. Now, in 1798, one of our young cadets got in trouble at Fort Norfolk because he had brought with him his own personal waiter. Now, these waiters were probably enslaved people, and the Army allowed you to have a waiter if you were a lieutenant or above, but cadets were not allowed that. So they are going to try to collect from his pay the rations he got for his personal waiter, because that was not allowed. So we probably had enslaved people serving the officers at Fort Norfolk and at Fort Nelson for the first few years that these forts existed. Now, Fort Norfolk was abandoned in 1808, and that looked like that was the end of Fort Norfolk. They decided that Fort Nelson would become the primary fortification to protect Norfolk and Portsmouth. But then we had the Chesapeake Leopard Affair take place in 1807. The Chesapeake Leopard Affair was when the USS Chesapeake was going out to sea for a cruise. And as they left the Chesapeake Bay, they were met by the HMS Leopard. Now, the HMS Leopard was looking for deserters from the British Navy. And they knew of 4 gentlemen who had deserted from the British Navy. And this is straight out of the Norfolk newspaper, that when they refused to give these men back to the British Navy, the British opened up their gun ports and opened fire on the Chesapeake. Well, the commander, Commodore Barron, was not ready for action because they were just leaving on their cruise and the gun deck was strewn with supplies and wood. So he was only able to get one shot off before he realized he could not win this battle, and he surrendered. Well, who was he defending? Who was he not willing to give up? Well, here's the description of the sailors he was not ready to give up with. The first one was William Ware, a Native American. So we have what they call an Indian-looking fellow, a Native American, is the first man he was not willing to give up. The second man he was not willing to give up was Daniel Martin. Now, Daniel Martin is a colored man. The next man is John Struckham, and he's a white gentleman. And the fourth person is not really named here. But a lot of people don't realize that the United States Navy in 1807 was integrated. Here we have Native Americans, Black Americans, and whites serving together on a ship. And if you've ever been on a ship of this time period, there's no place to segregate people. You're all on the ship together. And this was one opportunity for many of the free Black population that lived in Norfolk to join the Navy and go to sea. They also were involved in the merchant fleets of the area. So I thought it was quite impressive that even back in 1807, Commodore Barron was protecting a Black man and a Native American. The next thing is, in 1807, as a result of the Chesapeake Leopard Affair, they wanted to update the forts in Norfolk, and they're once again going to build Fort Norfolk. And the Fort Norfolk they constructed is the one that you see today, which was built in 1808 and 1809. Well, where did they get their labor to build the fort? Well, here's how they did it. This is a newspaper ad from 1807 when they're preparing to build the forts. If you notice, he simply puts an ad in the paper for laborers. So many of these laborers would be your typical white laborers. Some may have been free Blacks, but I have no documentation to prove it. And some may have been slaves that are hired out by their masters to build the fort. I have looked for documentation for 20 years, more than 20 years, on who these people were. I can't find it. It may exist, but I haven't gotten to it yet. So once again, we don't know if slave labor was used, but chances are they did use some when they were building Fort Norfolk. Okay. Now, the next time we have construction going on at Fort Norfolk is during the Civil War. During the Civil War, the Confederates, we do know, hired slaves from the slave owners to do work at Fort Norfolk. Here we have Lieutenant Talbot, and he is paying people for the use of their slaves. And the owner receives all this money, and the enslaved person receives nothing. Not exactly a fair arrangement. Now, the one thing we do know is that the United States government and even the Confederate government never owned slaves. They always would get their slave labor in this fashion. They would hire them from the owner. But there was one country in North America, colonial power, that actually did own slaves as a country, and that was Spain. And they had state-owned slaves down in St. Augustine. Now, this is what they were doing at Fort Norfolk in the early stages of the Civil War. See this area right here that's outside the front gate of Fort Norfolk? They were putting up gun positions outside the fort. Also inside the fort, which you can't see on this map that was drawn in 1862, is the original gun ramp for Fort Norfolk used to be right here. But when the Navy came in and they put in their big naval cistern, they tore up the original gun ramp. So the Confederates had to build a new gun ramp, and they built it right here, right between the magazine and one of the barracks. So that's our Confederate gun ramp. And if you come to Fort Norfolk, you can see that gun ramp today. And this gun ramp was definitely built using slave labor, because I have the receipts. And I found these receipts in the National Archives. The next part of our story actually starts at Fort Monroe in the very early part of the Civil War. In May of 1861, three black men who were enslaved stole the boat and rowed across Hampton Roads to Fortress Monroe. They presented themselves to the commanding officer at the fort, who was General Butler, and said, "We'd like our freedom." Butler kind of told them that, "I'm not really in that business of doing that, not in the business of freeing people." But then he talked to them for a while, and he found out that they were building fortifications at Sewell's Point. Now, Butler was a lawyer, and he then said, "Well, then we have something to work with, because you are property being used against the federal government, therefore we can seize you. You are contraband of war." Well, this decision to call them contraband of war and seize them, they had no use for them. They didn't enslave people. The federal government had never done that. So they set them free and actually gave them jobs. Well, soon the word got out. And this is a political cartoon from one of the northern newspapers. And word got out, and more people started running to Fort Monroe, and they were presenting themselves as contraband of war. And the numbers of people suddenly started growing. Well, then on May 10th, 1862, the Union Army lands at Ocean View, marches into Norfolk, not a shot is fired, but they capture Norfolk. And every Confederate manages to leave town. In fact, the mayor of Norfolk went out and gave a big speech to the Union Army to slow them down, so they could give them more time to get out of town. Well, as soon as the Union Army captures Norfolk, they take over Fort Norfolk. Now there's another fort. So now people don't have to swim the river or find a way to cross the river. They can come to Fort Norfolk, and they are declared contraband of war. Now, I didn't know anything about Norfolk being a refuge for a contraband of war until about 3 years ago, when I was taking a class at Old Dominion University, which then gave me access to their library, and me being a researcher, I went into their database that college students can access and just pulled up everything having to do with Fort Norfolk. And suddenly these letters appeared. Or actually, they were newspaper articles. And they came out of a strange place. They were all from Christian magazines up north. The first one comes out of the New York Evangelist, and you see the date on it, November of 1862, and they're talking about the contraband of war that are at Fort Norfolk. They are going to send them clothing because they need it, and they have 780 contraband at Fort Norfolk, 350 of them in a large storehouse and in barracks. This sounds like they're actually inside the fort at this point in time. Most of them are women because they're taking the men and putting them to work, giving them jobs with the Union Army. Now, the people are noting that their clothing, they're shoeless, their clothes are in bad shape, and they are compelled to just sleep on the ground or on boards or on bricks. The conditions are not good at Fort Norfolk for them. The Army was not really prepared for these people. We have another account that's just a month later where there's 690 contraband at Fort Norfolk. Once again, mostly women and children. And Captain Dawson is in charge. And they've had no new clothing since they arrived. And they're having to cut up the blankets that they've been given so their children have frocks. And they have no shoes. These are not good conditions, and they're not being taken care of very well. Now, what's different here is that by December of 1862, they're no longer inside Fort Norfolk. By this point, Fort Norfolk is now a prisoner of war camp for Confederate soldiers. Not only Confederate soldiers, but political prisoners. If they don't like you in Norfolk, they'll throw you in Fort Norfolk. And if you're a Union soldier that misbehaves and you're convicted of a crime, they will also throw you in Fort Norfolk. So you've got three different groups of people thrown together in Fort Norfolk, and they've thrown out the contraband, and so they're no longer in the fort. But that brought up the question, well, where did they go? They're still considered at Fort Norfolk. Now we have another report in January. And up north, I guess their math skills are very bad. None of these numbers will add up to the totals. I guess they didn't have very many quality controls in their journal. But it's listing more locations. Now we have contraband at Fort Norfolk. We have 690 there. We also have contraband at Craney Island and in Norfolk itself. So they're starting to spread out because they have more people. Now, by February, you still have John Dawson in charge, and there have been as many as 962 at Fort Norfolk. Once again, all the able-bodied men are taken off to do work. But they only have men who are infirmed at Fort Norfolk. They have about 50 that have measles, whooping cough, and diseases from exposure. So this, once again, shows that they're not really treating them that well. They have more deaths than births. And they're looking for clothes for the people. Well, clothes finally start making their way there. February of 1863, we have them sending clothes from Christian organizations, and they're going to Washington, Alexandria, Craney Island, Fort Monroe, Norfolk, and they're sending quite a few garments. Thousands of garments out for these people to have so that they can survive the cold. All right, so I went to William & Mary when I was on vacation in Williamsburg, and I knew that William & Mary had Commodore Barron's papers, so I wanted to go in and take pictures of them with my iPad. And while I was there, I always checked to see if anywhere I go has information on Fort Norfolk. And in their catalog showed up a map of Fort Norfolk. I was like, great, let me see this map. As soon as I saw this map, I was really excited. And the people in the research room was like, what's wrong with you? You know, it's just a map. And the reason I was so excited is this is Norfolk in 1861. And if you notice right here, here's Fort Norfolk up here, and there is no Brambleton Avenue Bridge. To get to the fort, you've got to go around by land to get to the peninsula. And on the map, I blew up the detail. Here's Fort Norfolk. And this is hand-drawn by one of the men that was assigned to the fort as a prison guard. Next to the fort, here's the street or the camp of the prison guards. But over in the far corner, there is the Negro quarters. This is where the contraband of war were kept. Now, this is at Fort Norfolk's at one end of Front Street. That's on the other end of Front Street. So this is where the contraband had their camp at Fort Norfolk. And this is something I never knew about, and I'd been studying Fort Norfolk for 25 years. Now, I have no pictures of the contraband camp in Norfolk. This is a picture at Harper's Ferry, where they put them up in tents. They made their own modifications, like they built a little chimney on the side of their tent here to stay warm. All right, so things are going along, not much news happening. And then January 1st, 1863, we have the Emancipation Proclamation. Of course, everybody believes that now all the slaves in the South are free. No, not quite. Here we have the actual document text. And if you notice, there are exceptions to the rule. In Virginia, the exceptions are 48 counties that are now West Virginia, and the following counties: Berkeley, Accomack, Northampton, Elizabeth City, York, Princess Anne, Norfolk, including the cities of Norfolk and Portsmouth. And so things are just as they were, as if this proclamation had not been issued. So slavery is still legal in Norfolk. So now you have this small body of water that separates Fort Norfolk from Norfolk. If you're at Fort Norfolk, you're free. If you're in Norfolk, you're enslaved. If you go from Norfolk to Fort Norfolk, they will just send you back because it's legal in this part of the country. Then another event takes place. In January 1864, the 1st Regiment of U.S. Colored Troops are sent to Fort Norfolk to take over as prison guards. Now, the way I found this information was, once again, I was on computer databases searching for information on Fort Norfolk, and I found a Richmond newspaper article where a Union soldier that was at Fort Norfolk got in trouble for insulting the Black Guard. And I was like, Black Guard? Well, this is news. I wonder who it is. So I went up to the National Archives and I asked them, do you have the order books for the Black Regiments? And they said, we have a few. I said, well, I'll start with the 1st Regiment and work my way through them. And I was lucky because the 1st Regiment was the ones that took over at Fort Norfolk as prison guards. Now, where did they stay? Well, they took over the camp that the 148th New York Company had. So this is where they would have been stationed and living. This is Colley Avenue here. So this is right across from Harbor's Edge, where Channel 13 has their studios. This is where the U.S. Colored Troops were, and they were right next to the contraband camp. Well, they didn't stay at Fort Norfolk long. On January 13th, they were ordered out of Fort Norfolk. But Fort Norfolk, as far as I know, is the only set of buildings that we have where we can say the U.S. colored troops were stationed here and the buildings still exist. Now, who were the 1st Regiment of U.S. colored troops? Well, the 1st Regiment was organized in Washington, D.C. in May of 1863. They were mustered into service on June 30th. They were trained on Mason's Island, which is now Theodore Roosevelt Island. It's a national park in the Potomac River just outside of D.C., or between Arlington and D.C. The first thing, they were sent down to Fort Monroe and immediately sent out to Plymouth, North Carolina and Elizabeth City, where they were involved in operations there. Then they returned to Norfolk in 1863 and spent a considerable amount of time in Norfolk. They did once again move out to South Mills and Canham Courthouse in North Carolina. But one thing everyone should realize is the North were a bit prejudiced. They would have U.S. colored troops, but they would have white officers. And I found the order books that list all the men that were in the Regiment of Colored Troops, and here are two of the officers in the order book. And the second one on the list is Second Lieutenant Sanborn. Notice he's murdered in Norfolk, Virginia, July 11th, 1863. Now, this is a bit confusing by the fact that the regiment is still training up in DC area, but he is in the Norfolk area. So he is probably down here recruiting more soldiers. And one place they would go to recruit soldiers is the contraband camps. And he was marching his soldiers down City Hall Avenue. And as they passed by one of the drugstores in Norfolk, a doctor who was actually a hero of the yellow fever epidemic, Dr. Wright, hollers at the officer and calls him a cowardly son of a blank. I'll let you fill in the rest of it. And really giving this officer a hard time. The officer confronts him, and next thing you know, Dr. Wright shoots the officer twice, and he dies. Well, there are a couple of stories about how the officer got, the doctor got the gun, whether it was handed to him or he had it with him. Now, in the National Archives, you can find the complete trial transcripts of Dr. Wright. And he is listed in the transcripts of being Lieutenant in Company B, 1st Regiment, U.S. Colored Troops. And when they asked the doctor what his plea was, he pleaded not guilty. Well, the trial went on, and it was a military trial, and he was tried by military officers. So he appealed the conviction. They would not let him appeal the convictions through the civil courts. It went up through the chain of command with the military until it got to Abraham Lincoln. And this is the letter that Abraham Lincoln sent to the officers in Norfolk, basically saying he was not insane when he pulled the trigger, hang him. And it was actually a thrill for me to handle a letter written by Abraham Lincoln and to be able to take pictures of it with my iPad. I've got the complete trial of Dr. Wright. Now, back to the 1st Regiment. After they were taken out of Fort Norfolk, and the reason they were taken out of Fort Norfolk was they were finally going to get their chance to be involved in combat during the war. And they were sent on Butler's operations against Petersburg and Richmond. They saw action at several places, assaults on Petersburg, the mine explosion that's listed up there. That is the Battle of the Crater that we've heard so much about in Petersburg. And Fort Harrison, you can actually go to Fort Harrison. It is part of the National Park Service. I've been there, and they actually don't mention the 1st Regiment of Colored Troops, but there were several regiments of colored troops in the area, and they actually have some of their pictures at the National Park there. Then they were sent to North Carolina, where once again they participated in several actions, and the most notable is down here at the bottom. On April 26, 1865, they were there when General Johnson and his armies surrender. This is after the surrender of Robert E. Lee. This is when you knew the Confederates were done. Then the 1st Regiment of U.S. Colored Troops was sent to Roanoke Island, and they stayed there until they were mustered out of service. And there was also a freeman camp at the same location. So I don't know if there's a connection there. Now, back to Norfolk and what's going on here. April 7th, 1864, we have a new constitution in Virginia. And this new constitution ends slavery in Virginia. This is when slavery ends in Norfolk. After this point, slavery is no longer going to be legal in Norfolk. But something about this just doesn't make sense, because Richmond doesn't fall for another year. In other words, it's almost exactly 1 year after this that the Confederates evacuate Richmond. So how do we get a new constitution if the government in Richmond is still there? Here's the answer. This is where slavery ends in Virginia. 415 Prince Street in Alexandria, Virginia. In this building, right here. You see that building, that's where Lincoln had set up his shadow government of Virginia. And it was meeting in the Bank of the Potomac building, and Governor Pierpont was the governor of the restored government of Virginia. So this was not only his governor's mansion, but also where the legislature met. So back to Fort Norfolk. Now, the war is almost over, and the Navy was given Fort Norfolk back from the Army that was using it as a prisoner of war camp. Now, the documentation is very confusing at this point, because they didn't release the last prisoner from Fort Norfolk until May of 1866. Yet the Navy is also at Fort Norfolk, once again using it as a naval weapons depot. So I cannot explain how all this happens at the same time yet. I'm working on it. But their request to hire one of the contraband is approved, and now we have the first free black worker at Fort Norfolk. By 1866, we have 10 or more free black workers at Fort Norfolk. Once again, the documentation isn't completely clear, because the Department of the Navy, the weapons officer who's in charge of Fort Norfolk, is constantly mailing back and forth with the Department of Ordnance in DC, and this is where I'm getting my information. So they got 9 contraband on the 4th of January, and they already had one, and I do not know if they hired any more in between. Now, one reason they were probably hiring the contraband is because you weren't going to hire the locals because they could be Confederate sympathizers. And you don't really want them around your gunpowder and your cannonballs. Not a good idea. All right, so now we go along and we have the passage of the 13th Amendment to end slavery in the entire country. The 13th Amendment is passed by Congress January 13th, 1865. And it is ratified by Virginia February 6th through the 9th, 1865. Once again, Richmond has not fallen yet. So it is the reconstituted government in Alexandria that ratifies the 13th Amendment. And there were actually representatives from Norfolk that were there in the ratification process. It was a total of 17 men that ratified the amendment to the Constitution. Only one man voted against it. The other 16 voted for it. We had representatives from Alexandria, Norfolk, Portsmouth, Hampton, the Eastern Shore. In other words, there are 6 senators and 11 delegates, and that made up the General Assembly of Virginia in Alexandria. Now, finally, the 13th Amendment becomes law of the nation after Georgia ratifies the Constitution in December of 1865, and slavery ends in the United States, and Delaware and Kentucky, 2 states that fought for the North, are forced to free their slaves. So the last holdout for slavery wasn't in the South, it was the states that fought for the North, which is something most people aren't aware of. Now, to wrap up my lecture, I want to make 2 final points. And this is why I give this lecture. Everyone should be allowed to honor their ancestors, even if they disagreed with your ancestors. Help do this by helping them to preserve their history and their historic sites. To do anything else would be wrong. And I believe that we need to preserve everyone's history, that we need to make sure that no one's history is left out. My last point is, today, human trafficking is illegal slavery. And we need to do more with our legislators and also our general population to become aware of this form of slavery, because the victims are mostly women of all races, and it's something that really needs to stop.